What's up, brother?
What's going on?
I need to tell you some things you're not going to want to hear. I need you to listen.
Pleased to have with us in the studio Kevin Camps, the radioactive waste watchdog with Beyond Nuclear. BeyondNuclear.org is the website, and you can tweet him at Beyond Nuclear. Kevin, welcome back.
Thank you, Tom.
Great having you with us. You got to get within 3 inches of that mic there for us to hear you. 6 years after Fukushima began, normalizing radiation exposure risks to the health of women and men and women, the evacuees are given few options but to return to contamination is a headline. What's the story? What's going on at Fukushima right now?
Yeah, my coworker Cindy Folkers, who is our radiation and health hazard specialist, just wrote an article in Counterpunch that traced the word origin of the word radiophobia. And it turns out that it comes all the way from 1951 during the height of atmospheric weapons testing days. And it was written by a nuclear establishment type who was making good money in the nuclear establishment, had no credentials in psychology, and just dismissed everybody's concerns about radiation health damage, called it radiophobia. It's all in your head. It's your fault. It's your problem. So that was used quite extensively at Chernobyl. It's being used at Fukushima. And so what's going on at Fukushima is the pro-nuclear Japanese government is moving people back, forcing people to move back to contaminated areas under threat of losing their compensation. And the compensation is going to end about a year from now. So people are given the choice of being destitute elsewhere in Japan or moving back to their former homes, which are radioactively contaminated, and keeping compensation for another year at least. But mothers who are concerned about their children's health are being accused of radiophobia, but it's all in their head. But in fact, they have increased allowable radiation exposures 20-fold in these areas around Fukushima.
Germany did the same thing with milk after Chernobyl. I was living in Germany, 86, 87, and they, it was, I think, 5 becquerels per liter, and then they took it up to 20, and then they took it to 50, and then they took it to 100, and just because the milk was getting more and more radioactive, and rather than dumping it, they just kept changing the standards, as I recall. Correct me if I'm wrong.
The Soviets were even worse. It came out 10 years after Chernobyl began in 1996 that the Soviet Politburo had ordered contaminated foods of various sorts, milk, meat, to be mixed in with the food supply of the entire Soviet Union and to dissipate or dilute the radioactivity. But of course, what that meant was that food that should have been quarantined and destroyed because it was unfit for human consumption now was exposing millions or tens of millions of people to radioactive exposures. The same kind of thing's happening in Japan where, what's really incredible is the Japanese food safety standards post-Fukushima are much stronger than American or Canadian standards. So the figure in Japan is 100 becquerels per kilogram of radioactive cesium in food. That's considered legal and edible. In the United States, it's 1,200.
Really?
So what that means is that Japan's contaminated food can be exported to the United States and sold legally on the open market.
Is it?
You have to assume there have been stories that have come out where food from Fukushima Prefecture itself was not marked as such, and it was supposed to be, showing up in various parts of Asia. And once that scandal was uncovered, certain countries have banned all imports from not just Fukushima, but from other neighboring prefectures. So there's been a real blowback against this deception that's going on, trying to keep it quiet that food out of Fukushima is being sold.
I had somebody call the other day about this who was saying, because Fukushima, the meltdown continues, the robots are dying, they can't get a handle on this. There's enormous amounts of radioactive water continuously, every day, every second, pouring into the Pacific Ocean. Concerned that fish that migrate from our side of the Pacific to the Japanese side of the Pacific, particularly presumably large fish like tuna, might be bringing cesium with them. And of course, it's the plume has already crossed the Pacific, or they might just be picking it up in the normal course of swimming around and breathing water and all that kind of stuff, running through their gills, whatever the word is for fish. Mm-hmm. How real a risk is that? That the if you are eating Pacific Ocean fish, that you may be getting a dose of radiation with your food. What percentage of the fish that comes out of the West Coast, and particularly for people who live on the West Coast or west of the Mississippi, presumably, What percentage of that fish is actually tested for radioactive material before it ends up on our dinner plates?
Actually, Pacific bluefin tuna was documented in August of 2011, so 5 months after Fukushima began, as measurably contaminated with radioactive cesium. It had grown as a juvenile stage on the northeastern coast of Japan there, near Fukushima, had swam across the ocean and carried the radioactivity in its own flesh over to the west coast of North America. So that was 5 months after Fukushima began. We're now 6 years.
6 years ago.
We're now 6 years beyond that. And so that plume you mentioned has contaminated, incredibly enough, the Pacific Ocean all the way from Japan to the west coast of North America, doubled in radioactivity content because of Fukushima, artificial radioactivity. It already had pollution from atom bomb testing galore in the Pacific and elsewhere in the Northern Hemisphere that went on for years and decades. And then Fukushima alone doubled the registered readings of things like cesium-134, cesium-137 in open ocean water lapping on the shores of the west coast of North America. And the dynamic that you have to watch out for big time is bioaccumulation, bioconcentration, biomagnification, where fish species like bluefin tuna, other predatory fish species that are at the top of the food chain are going to have a concentrated dose of radioactivity. Big fish eats little fish. Little fish is already radioactively contaminated and it just builds up. And so that testing question you asked, the United States government since Fukushima began has been derelict in its duty, has not been testing the food supply. It's woefully inadequate what's going on. And in terms of atmospheric measurements in the first days and weeks after Fukushima, it was revealed that something like a third of the Environmental Protection Agency's radiation monitors in the United States were dysfunctional. They were not operating. The batteries hadn't been replaced. And it, you know, showed utter incompetence for one thing, but I think it's even worse than incompetence. It's an intentional downplaying of the health risks of Fukushima fallout.
So it's the EPA and presumably the USDA who are responsible for this. I mean, these are agencies that with the Trump administration, they want to slash radically. So odds are we're never going to find out how radioactive our food is.
Unless we turn things around. I mean, you know, to give credit where credit's due or negative credit, the Obama administration on January 19th, hours before Trump took the oath of office, finalized a scandalous policy. It's called Protective Action Guidelines for Radioactivity in Drinking Water. And what the Obama administration did was increased allowable levels of radioactivity, and it depends on the isotope you're talking about, tens of times, hundreds of times, thousands of times, millions of times, depending on the isotope. It was a wholesale regulatory rollback, and it was based on what the Japanese government was able to get away with post-Fukushima. The U.S. decided if it's good enough for Japan, it's good enough for us. They just sold a shop on radioactivity and water post-nuclear incident.
Whoa. So who's beyondnuclear.org, I'm assuming, is pushing back on this. Are there other groups? Is anybody raising a stink about this? I mean, this is... You might want to talk about Chernobyl heart. I mean, how, you know, what's the consequence of eating cesium or strontium?
Yes, I mean, Nuclear Information and Resource Service has watchdogged that attempt to roll back those regulations for decades and was able to stop it time and time again. Even during the George W. Bush years, they tried at the end of the George W. Bush administration to do this. Mm-hmm. What Obama ended up doing, despite best efforts by groups like Nuclear Information and Resource Service, was to do worse than W was going to do.
Whoa. Is this because of a revolving door at these agencies? Is this because of lobbying by the nuclear industry? Is this because there's some legitimate reason to do it? I mean, why?
It makes the world a whole lot easier for the nuclear power industry. If they have an incident and they leave it that ambiguous, it's not necessarily a nuclear power catastrophe of the scale of Fukushima or Chernobyl. It could be something like a medical isotope shipment in a vehicle that crashes and releases its contents into the environment. Any incident all along that spectrum, these are going to be the allowable levels of radioactivity in water until the U.S. government can get its handle on things, and that could take years. Wow. So people will be exposed to, and you mentioned Chernobyl heart, radioactive cesium-134, radioactive cesium-137, where does that go in the human body? It goes to muscle tissue, including the heart. And so Chernobyl Heart is the title of an Oscar Award-winning short documentary from over a decade ago that showed that congenital heart defects in babies in Chernobyl are bad.
This is the Tom Hartman Program.
Kevin Camps, Radioactive Waste Watchdog with Beyond Nuclear, beyondnuclear.org. Kevin, thank you for being with us.
Thank you so much.
We'll be right back.
I need to tell you some things you're not going to want to hear. I need you to listen. Trust that what I want is the best thing for our club.
Absolutely.
That recommendation was a mayhem vote.
Mother of Christ, Jack. That's just not going to happen.
Chips, no. You need to hear me out. All right?
具体的にね、農業でね、どういう問題があるかちょっと発言します。よく聞いてちょうだい。
私は福島県で、専業で、農業を現在も行っています。私の、住んでいる須賀川は昨年、玄米から100ベクレルを超える米が全国一番で100ベクレルを超えてしまいました。それで田んぼ、除染する結果になったんですけれども、私たちは農地の土壌が何ベクレルあるかもわからないで作業してるんですよ。毎日空間染料じゃないんですよ。で、田んぼを除染するっていうことになって、私の地区は作業員はその地区の農家の私も作業員になってやったんです。仕事除染の除っていう意味が分かってます？深く耕してない、薄めてダメじゃねえの。取り除いて見えたから放射のなんて下がるわけないでしょ。田んぼ除染しました、空間線量剥がりました、全然下がってないですよ。取り除いてねえの。そうでしょう。原発が爆発した当時と環境はもう2年経っても何にも変わってないんだから。農業資材だって汚染されてれば、被覆資材などは使用してダメだっていう指示が出てます。それも農家が何ベクレルあるなんてわからないですよ。で、新しく買い直ししてどうしてくれんの。農家の思いっていうのをよく考えてみてください。私たちは作物を生産して安心安全なものを自分でも食べて消費者の方にも販売して、そういう収穫の喜びが今はないんです。福島県のものは県外のものに比べたら本当に値段も安いですから、それを承知しながら作って損害賠償をもらって、農家は何の活力がありますか。あと一つ言っておくことがあるんですけれども、福島県は農作物は 出荷の前に全部検査しないと出荷できません。今は100ベクレル以下っていうことになってますけれども、農家が生産している私は頑張りますよ、これが何ベクレルあるって。放射能要は100ベクレル以下だったら出荷できるわけですから、私は食べませんよ。買って食べる人は放射能メイド持って買って食ってるって、どうなんの。俺らは分かってんだよ、罪の意識なんて作ってなって。自分は食わねえけど人の人に食わせてんの。どう思いますか、ちょっと答えてください。
じゃあ関連して、ちょっと待って、関連して、今は深川地区のね農業の話をしました。もう一つ相馬の玉野地区というところの話をします。それを含めて答えて。
玉野地区っていうのは相馬市の西部にあって、飯舘地区とほとんど放射能の濃度は変わらない、高いんですよ。山の中に入ると毎日7、10マイクロシーベルトっていう土地ばっかりなんですよ。除染はしています、部分的に。だけど畑の作物の収入の賠償金が米の農家と違って賠償されないっていう例がいっぱいあるんです。でしかも住民の状況はそういう状況で生活していても自主的な地域です。生活に対する保障も不十分、精神に対する保障も不十分、二重の苦しみである。そういう地域が線引きによる救済から全く漏れていっぱい残っている。こういうことをもう一度国も東電も含めて、その線引きから漏れた人たちの実例がいっぱいある。こういう訴えは決して漏らさないで、きちっと把握して救済していただきたい。それとこの先ほどもおっしゃったけれども、ただ自分の子供にね、例えば100ベクレルない食べ物であって50ベクレルとか、あるいは簡易な検出器は10ベクレルぐらいから下は不検出になるんです。まあ安いやつはね、そんな高い性能のいいやつはなかなかそれがない。アルファ化学性もベータ性もガンマ性も全部測れるなんてのはなかなか高くて手に入らない。ガンマ性だけですよ、セシウムの普通は測るのは。でそれで測って不検出なんていうものを消費者が本当に信じて食べるか、食べないんですよ。そういう内訳が分かってるから。で、あなたも、ね、西田さんもおっしゃる、私が聞きたい、それから文科省のあなたにも聞きたいが、自分の子供に例えば10ベクレルだから、これ不検出100ベクレルよりもはるかに低いんだから OK だよと言われて、それを進んで食べさせたいと思いますか。食べたいと自分でも思いますか。西田さん食べるんですか。私は進んで食べる。ああ、犠牲的な精神でとてもいっぱいある。でも子供には食べさせないんですよ。それが実態ですよ。西田さんは私と同じか、まあ、私と似たような年合いだからもうしょうがねえや、役目から死んでみせようとあるかもしれないが、自分の子供にはそれ食わせたいと思わないでしょ。放射能ってのはそういうもんですよ。指導さんののんきにそこにかば座って見せているけれども、自分の子供には食わせたい、そこで済ませたいとは思わないでしょ。これがね、国家がきちっとやんなきゃなんない本当の問題なんです。それをね、それを今の中間指針随後だか何かで書いていない、それをきちっとやらない最低基準だと国は明言しているにもかかわらず、東電はそれを手当てを取らない、それを大の場で配って見て聞いて知っているにもかかわらず、権限を持っているね、規制権限を持っている国がそれに対してね一言も言わない、こんな情けないことがどこにあるか。私はね、先ほど皆様の人格誇りということを申し上げた。私は同じ人間だから、皆様のことはね、同じ思いで敬服をいたしますよ、人間として。だけど、さっきの誤りの話にもあったけれども、 人間としてあなた方は相当大きく自分の職業で自分の地位を守ることはそれは必要かもしれないが、やっちゃいけないところまで踏み込んでるんです。
そうです。
ここ今どこに行ったんだ。ジャイマーの上に食べさせたくない、素直にそういう思いはね、皆さん持ってると思いますよ。あなたもそうでしょ。小さな子供はまだ独身かもしれない、だこれから子供を持ちますよ。その子供になるべく保護者の方から遠ざけたいと思うんでしょ。それをその自分の素直な思いを国政に反映させられない、そんな情けない国家公認なんておりやるか。人の命を危険にさらすんだったら自分もその覚悟を持てよ。誇りだろ、これが人間の。
もちろんあのご指摘通りでございます。なかなかその責任万能というふうに受け取られる方としてですね、なかなかそうなっていないという実情でございますので、まあ、そうしたところはきちんと賠償で対応していくという形でございます。あの先ほどあの福島のものを、食べれるのかというのをご指摘いただきました。これはあの福島県の方では、例えば、まあ、経産省の方にもですね、実はその福島県産の、まあ、お米の直売会みたいなのがですね、ございまして、そういったものについてもですね、あの私はこれ個人的な話でございますけども、あの買ってですね、あの家の家族のものと一緒に食べたりしているところでございます。まあ、こういった形であの福島県の農家の方々の風評がですね、まあ、少しでも大変すればですね、これはやはり、そうした形に持っていくべきというふうに思っておりますので、我々としてはそうしたやはり安全なものは安全、やはり本当に危険なものは危険なものとしてですね、きちんと対処していかなきゃいけませんが、安全なものは安全という形でですね、これは風評の解消に努めるということをですね、国としても努力してまいりたいと思います。これはあの単に賠償だけの問題ではなくて、農業政策の観点からですね、そうした風評の解消というのはこれまた農水省の方でございますけど、彼らもまた努力しているところでございますので、やはり国としましては、何回も申し上げますけれども、そうした風評解消に努力という形でですね、福島県農家の皆さんの活動をですね、サポートしていきたいと思います。
はい、次は冬を冬のついて皆さん参加してもら
う。風評風評って言うけどね、風評じゃないんですよ。いいですか、風評ってのは根も葉もないことなの、根にも葉にもあんの、わかる。物柄ってないからいいじゃないんだって。農家は農地汚染されて何千ベクレルっていうんです。私は測ってます。全部あるんですよ。それ持ってってくれよ。そう言うんだったら、風評被害って言うんだったら、全部持ってってくれ。で、物柄ってないからいいんじゃないんだよ。わかるよね。いつも言ってるよね、不動産。そういうことなんだよ。それで賠償されてるって言ってるでしょ。賠償されないのあんだって西田さんに何か言ってるじゃないですか。されないんです。今も止まってるやついっぱいあるんです。リンゴの賠償出ないんです。福島市の農家で指導してますか。指導さんに指導してよ、ちゃんとやってよ。それ言ってんだけど全然進んでないでしょ。そういうことなの。